Hi, I am Jacobo Asorey. It's a pleasure to be speaking again on this conference. Last year, I talked to you about H1R4 simulations of intensity mapping. This year, I am premiering this paper we submitted recently to the archive about the future of radio continuum clustering cosmology surveys done in collaboration with David Parkinson. Since the beginning of humanity, we have tried to describe and explain the universe, and for a particular reason, we like circular theoretical models, like in the Ptolemy model, the Copernican model, and nowadays we have a cosmological model based on the homogeneity and isotropy of the universe, which is also described by this circle. This circle just describes the proportions of the energy components filling the universe nowadays. And we have a 5% of the universe is in the form of ordinary matter, well explained by the standard model of particle physics, and the 95% of the universe is what we call the dark sector, and we still don't know yet what it is composed of. So regarding the matter, it seems that most of matter in the universe is in the form of what we call dark matter, for which we have several astrophysical evidences, but we yet don't know what it is. And then most of the universe nowadays is in the form of dark energy, which is causing the cosmic acceleration. And it seems all the data sets agree or are more consistent with a particular type of dark energy, which is the cosmological constant in the Einstein equations. This model works really well compared with data, but there are still some remaining open questions. For example, is the cosmic acceleration described by lambda or not? We hopefully will answer to this question in this decade. Then what is dark matter? We don't know yet. Or what are the initial conditions? Where do the structures we are part of coming from? To study this and to actually build this model, we have explored the universe in different epochs, especially analyzing the anisotropies of the cosmic microwave background radiation in the early universe. And then in the late universe, in the last 20 years, we have been able to increase a lot our knowledge on the cosmological model. For example, with Taiwanese supernovas, we found the acceleration of the universe, the cosmic acceleration. Or with galaxy surveys, we have been able to measure the galaxy clustering, measure the expansion rate too, and also study the growth of structures in the universe. But nowadays, some tensions have arisen in the last years with respect to the lambda CDM model or between the lambda CDM model and the data. For example, the Hubble-Lemaitre constant, which tells us the expansion rate of the universe locally, the estimations from Taiwanese supernovae, for example, and CMB have some tension. Or the estimation of the amplitude of clustering from CMB and galaxy surveys also has some tension. What is this tension telling us? It could be that we have some systematics we don't know in the late universe or in the early universe or in both, or we need new physics. We can explore the so-called redshift desert. And what is the redshift desert? It's the redshift range not that much explored in the past, which probably can be defined between redshift 2 and the dark ages. So exploring this redshift desert, for example, with radio surveys, will allow us to identify what is going on between the early universe and the late universe. One of the most important observable in cosmology is the distribution of fluctuations in the universe. And this is analyzed usually with the power spectrum of the distribution of fluctuations. But these fluctuations are only seen through tracers, for example, galaxies or photons that are affected by dark matter too, through weak lensing, or the photons from the CMB. This power spectrum has different behaviors at different scales. And at the larger scales, we have only been able to measure how it is with CMB measurements. And the information from these larger scales is coming directly from the initial conditions of the universe. It's telling us about the primordial power spectrum of fluctuations, how they were initially. But with galaxy clustering and weak lensing, we have only been able to measure the smaller scales part of this power spectrum, which is telling us information from the universe, the evolution of the universe later. So one way to study this discrepancy between the early universe and the late universe through the tensions is to actually try to measure the primordial power spectrum or the largest scales of the power spectrum with galaxy clustering. To do so, we need larger volumes in order to sample the larger modes. How can we do that? Increasing the redshift range, which can be done with, for example, radio frequencies. As can be seen here, optical survey seems to have a limiting redshift at redshift 2. So we want to go beyond that, for example, with the ASCAP, the Australian Square Kilometer Array Evolutionary Map of the Universe Survey, which is a radio continuum survey, we can reach redshift of almost 4. And with SKA, we will reach even larger, the Square Kilometer Array, we will even be able to reach higher redshifts and therefore higher volumes in order to sample this primordial part of the power spectrum. In radio cosmology, we have three different types of observables. For example, for resolved galaxies, we can determine the position of the 21 centimeter line and then do an actual map of galaxies at low redshift. At higher redshifts, we cannot resolve the galaxies, but we can create maps of the unresolved emission of the 21 centimeter line through what we call intensity mapping at different redshifts. So we have an actual three-dimensional map of intensity of hydrogen. And then continuum galaxy surveys. What are continuum galaxy surveys? Basically, we measure the total, the intensity of the total radio emission across all the wavelengths of our antenna or telescope. This emission is mostly dominated by synchrotrons, which with a featureless spectrum, and is mostly coming from AGNs and from star-forming galaxies. And at the end of the observations, we will end with a catalog which has the angular positions of the continuum galaxies, and then the total flux, but no redshift information. So this is a problem in terms of we are missing all the radial information in the clustering. We can try to using other information from other wavelengths to try to subdivide this sample in redshift bins, but just directly from continuous surveys, we only have the angular positions and the flux. But we can reach really high areas, for example, with MVSS, 3/4 of the sky. If we are able to subdivide, as I said, the sample using clever techniques, we can reach unprecedented precision levels on measurements on, for example, the non-Gaussianities on the power spectrum, the primordial non-Gaussianities, which are related with initial conditions, or the evolution of dark energy in case it is not a cosmological constant. Another alternative to redshift binning is using the multi-tracer technique. In the multi-tracer technique, we sample the same volume with two different tracers of the fluctuations. And if the shot noise is negligible, this will remove the sample variance noise. So in order to see if there are any limitations to these surveys, we have checked two different types. One, the ones, two different types of limits. The ones related with the clustering statistics, mostly through shot noise, which is related with the number of radio galaxies, which is one of the limiting factors of radio surveys with respect to optical surveys, and then the on-sky radio survey limits, such as the foreground emission, the confusion noise, or the masking of bright sources. Regarding the clustering statistics, because we have the projected information of the clustering, we analyze it with the angular power spectrum. If we assume the linear and Gaussian model, the error of the angular power spectrum is given by a sample variance component, which is given by the angular power spectrum itself, and the shot noise, which depends on the number of galaxies in a redshift bin and a given flux cut. For the angular power spectrum, the computation of it depends on a window function, and this window function depends on the redshift distribution of our sources and a galaxy bias of the radio population. The redshift distribution may depend also on the flux cut we are using in our survey. In order to test all this, we have used the T-Rex simulation, which is a simulated radio catalog based on N-body simulations, to get the redshift distribution for different flux cuts, and then we have assumed the Halo model for the bias. Here, you can see the evolution with faint cut of the distribution of galaxy. We can see that for the faintest flux cut, the dominating type is the star forming galaxies. And then AGNs are the smaller component. But if we move towards brighter cuts, the AGNs start dominated exactly at the flux limit of, for example, the EMU survey or the meerkat survey. And then at really bright cuts, we only have AGNs in our sample. As I mentioned before, the limiting factor in clustering statistics is going to be the shot noise. Why? Because we can see here that if we increase the flux cut, we reduce the number of galaxies in our sample. And at some moment, the error coming from the shot noise is going to be the dominant source. So we need to determine for which flux cut this starts to happen. But there is another problem is if we do subdivide the sample in redshift bins, for each redshift bin, also shot noise is going to increase because we have reduced the total amount of galaxies. So what we did is for each flux cut, we did a subdivision, and then we check what is the limit in which the shot noise contribution to the total error budget is 10%, which is given by this red line. For an EMU or Mirka type of survey, which are almost 50 microjansky flux cut, we cannot subdivide the sample in redshift bins. For future SK surveys, which may reach the microjansky scale, we may be able to subdivide the sample. What happens if we do the multi-tracer technique? So we only consider, for example, AGNs, the shot noise is always contributing more than 10% to the total error budget for any flux cut and any subdivision in redshift bins. Therefore, we will not be able for any survey to use the multi-tracer technique because of the limiting amount of AGNs. So now let's go to the on-sky radio limits. First one is related to the fact that when we extract sources to create our catalogs from the observations, we need to extract them with respect to a background noise in the images. This RMS, basically this noise, is given by a combination of the noise from the thermal noise from the telescope, and then the sky diffuse emission, which is given by photons. We go to really faint flux cuts, this diffuse emission may actually become dominant, and we may need to drop significant parts of the sky. For example, as we do when we remove the Milky Way from clustering because it's the dominant part there, and we cannot use that area of the sky to do any cosmology. So what we check is that this RMS depends on the integration time. And then if we are able to have integration time of 2 hours, then for the standard detectors with 50K thermal emission, we are fine. The foregrounds will not be the problem. So this is not going to be a limiting factor given enough integration time. There are other intrinsic limits or natural limits. One is produced by the resolution of our antennas. So for any faint source that is not resolved because it's smaller than the resolution of our telescope, what will happen is that the beam will combine all these unresolved sources and spuriously will think or will introduce it as one source affecting our clustering. This is what we call the confusion noise. And it just depends on the number of sources above the flux cut and the solid angle of the beam. And what we can estimate is for a given resolution of a given telescope, like the ASCAP or the SKA, we can determine what is the confusion limit, which will be a limiting factor in our survey. For example, for EMU, the depth, the flux cut will be at 50 microjansky, and for SKA, we will almost reach the nanojansky. So this will set strong limit in surveys. But there is another size we may worry about, not just the resolution of the telescope, but about the intrinsic size of the radio galaxies. What happens if radio galaxies are so big that actually start overlapping, producing a similar noise? In a similar way, in optical deep surveys, we have the same thing with the blending of galaxies. for this natural confusion, instead of using the solid angle of the beam, we need to use the source solid angle. For that, we need the size of the object. So we can compare observations. Here you can see the dots from different catalogs. Then we can use the T-Rex simulation, which has some simulated sizes for the radio catalogs. And then we see that for star-forming galaxies from T-Rex, this agrees quite well with the what we call the Windhorst formula, which is a phenomenological relation between the flux and the size of the object. But then regarding AGNs, also T-Rex does an extrapolation from brighter fluxes to the never explored fainter end, because we have no data from this at these depths. For the steep spectrum AGNs, T-Rex predicts monster size steep spectrum AGNs. And even if their number is not that big, their size, the predicted size from T-Rex will actually not allow us to go beyond a flux cut of 100 nanojoules. So even if the normal confusion limit for SK may go to the nanojoules, this natural confusion will actually put a higher threshold. So if this extrapolation from T-Rex is true, the monster AGNs will make us stop at 100 nanojoules. But we have not only a problem with the faint end, we may have a problem with the bright end too. When we have sources beyond the bright end, we have to clean them, but when cleaning them, parts of it, for example, the jets of an AGN, a bright AGN, may actually come back as a faint source. This is spurious signal. In order to avoid it, we can mask the bright sources. But depending on the dynamical range, which is a relation between the bright and the faint cut, we will end removing significant parts of the sky. So in order to keep the total fraction of the sky, for the natural confusion limit we just found of 100 nanojoules, we will need a dynamical range of 70 decibels. So to sum up, the radio continuum cosmological survey will allow to explore the redshift desert and try to solve the open questions in cosmology. For continuum surveys, ongoing continuum surveys such as EMI and MIRCAT, we both have around a 50-100 microjoules limit. We will only be able to use one redshift beam. We will not be able to actually subdivide the sample in redshift beams. If we want to subdivide the redshift sample, we need to reach a 50 nanojoules level. If we want to use the multi-tracer technique, we will not be able to do so because the number of AGNs in the universe is so small that it's going to be a limiting factor, the most important one. If we have enough integration time, the diffusion emission from foregrounds is not going to be a limiting factor, but T-Rex simulation predicts a faint flux monster AGN population. And if this is true, then we will not be able to reach deeper fluxes than 100 nanojoules due to its natural confusion limit. And in order to keep the fraction of sky we want, for this sub-microjoules limit, we need to reach a dynamical range of 70 decibels. Here in this table, you can see the optimal configuration and subdivision in redshift beams for different projected and ongoing surveys. Thank you very much, and keep safe. Looking forward for your questions.